elevation of boiling point. Look, we have seen the moment we put a non-volatile solute into a solvent that is of course volatile, then there is a reduction in the vapor pressure of the solution, because the solute particles come and occupy the surfaces from where the evaporation becomes obstructed, right? Now, first of all, how does the boiling occur? The process of boiling, how does it occur? Say, I have a solvent, okay, and I have these solvent molecules. Now a point comes, say consider it to be supported, not hanging, right? So what happens? A point comes in where, and I know, see, the vapor pressure at room temperature, it is some value. You increase the temperature, vapor pressure increases, right? And you must be aware that vapor pressure is never ever dependent on the amount of the pure solvent. So you take half a liter of water or you take a bucket of water, the vapor pressure has to be the same, okay? Now, what happens when you start heating up, the vapor pressure increases. Vapor pressure, we are right now talking about a pure solvent, okay? So pure solvent, the vapor pressure increases with increase in temperature, correct? With the increase in temperature. So the vapor pressure is going up. Now what happens? A point comes where it equals the atmospheric pressure, right? So at the temperature where the vapor pressure, equals the atmospheric pressure, and by equal I mean where it just passes that, the liquid begins to boil. The liquid, in this case the pure solvent, begins to boil, correct? It begins to boil, fine. So it begins to boil, and that is the point where you say that temperature is the temperature which is called the boiling point. At the temperature where the vapor pressure equals this temperature is called, this temperature is called the boiling point of that liquid. Boiling point of the solvent. Get the point? That is called the boiling point of the solvent. Correct? So it is the matching of the vapor pressure that leads to the boiling, right? Boiling. So now, putting a non-volatile solute, lowers the vapor pressure. And we know the reason, correct? What's the reason? You put the solute particles, evaporation is a surface phenomena, isn't it? It is a surface phenomena, whenever the evaporation takes place, it's always about the molecules which are at the surface, which are at the interface, okay, the liquid air interface, which evaporate.
Now what happens? So
okay, so what happens at this interface, some of the solute particles, they take up these positions, right? Now what happens? The number of molecules which are exposed to the environment, that goes down. So the number of molecules that are liable to, that have a tendency to evaporate, they become less, and the vapor pressure dips. That's all that we know. So the vapor pressure dips. So what happens? You have to heat it more so that it reaches that vapor pressure, the so that the vapor pressure of the solution reaches the atmospheric pressure. Okay, so the solution has to be heated more for the vapor pressure, for its vapor pressure to become equal to the atmospheric pressure. Get the point? Correct? Now, if I draw the temperature in Kelvin versus the pressure, okay, in atmosphere of any solvent, and I know that it increases, okay, so what happens at 1 atmosphere? This is my 1 atmosphere line. This is 1 atm, okay, 1 atmosphere. Fine. Now my solvent has a characteristic like that. So this is pure solvent. When I say solvent, I mean pure solvent. You see, obviously I increase the temperature, my vapor pressure, this is the vapor pressure, okay, of my solvent. Now what if I have a solution, I have put some non-volatile solute in it, and what happens? So let us say at every point at this temperature, it will go down by something, okay, so it will be kind of this. We get that. This is my solution at a given concentration of solute, right? Solution. Now what happens? If it was a pure solvent, my boiling point was this, TB naught, I say. Now what happens? You just see this thing, the solution cuts the 1 atmosphere line at a higher temperature. It has to, okay? So this is the boiling point of the solution, right? This is the boiling point of the solution. You see that the solution has got a higher boiling point, right? This is a higher thing. This is all positive, right? So we see the phenomena. Now the this thing delta TB is equal to TB minus TB naught. That is called the elevation in boiling point. That is called elevation in boiling point, right? And it has been experimentally found out, okay,
through experiments, it has been found out
that this delta TB, that is the elevation in the boiling point, is directly proportional to the molality. Okay, understand that? So that elevation in boiling point is directly proportional to the molality of the
solute.
So what do we mean? We mean that delta TB is directly proportional to M, and as my proportionality sign goes away, in comes a
constant.
Okay, and this is called boiling point elevation constant, or it's called KB. Is called boiling point elevation constant, or molal elevation constant, or molal elevation constant, or, which I like the most, ebullioscopic constant. There is a word in English, ebullient. What does that mean? Ebullient is he was ebullient with joy. What does that mean? He was bubbling with joy, you know, so much so that all that bubbling was visible on the surface, as it is visible in case of boiling liquid, right? So ebullient is in a positive sense. He was ebullient with joy, okay, and it has come from boiling. So you're boiling with joy in a sense, right? So that's why this ebullience is from there. So it is boiling constant, kind of, okay. Now, if that is the case, then delta TB, if the solute is W2 and its molar mass is M2, that divided by W1 by 1000. What is molality? Molality is number of moles of the solute divided by the amount of solvent in kg. So W1 is mass of solvent in grams. That's why I had to divide it by 1000. Okay, so you remember that W2 is mass of the solute in grams, M2 is molar mass of solute, correct? It is the molar mass of the solute. Now, if I have that, and we have been emphasizing the point that our aim is to find out the molar mass. I am there to find out the molar masses, right? So, what is the molar mass? This M2 goes here, no? this 1000 goes up, M2 goes there. So what does that become?
It becomes actually equal to W2 upon W1 into 1000 upon M2.
Correct? So,
and obviously KB is there. Okay? The bolioscopic constant is there.
Now what if I take M2 there, then there's that cross movement.
And I get M2 is equal to, if M2 goes there, delta TB comes here. So I have KB into W2 into 1000 upon delta TB into W1.
That's how you find out. So if I tell you the elevation in the boiling point and everything else, then you understand how much solvent you took and how much solute you took, then you will be able to tell me. And KB is obviously a constant, so that is known. So immediately I get to know the value of M2. Okay. So this is what will govern us. Fine? In finding out the molar mass in case we are given the elevation in boiling point.